turn two chapters after where we were last week into Ephesians chapter 6. Ephesians 6. Back in Ephesians chapter 4, last week I preached on how we should not give place to the devil, how we create environment and a climate for the devil in our lives, in our families, in our homes, in our cities, in our churches, in our communities, and in our country. Paul is writing a letter to people in Ephesus, to people that he greatly loves. In chapter 4, he's talking to them about walking together in unity. And then he talks about spiritual gifts and how they should be using their spiritual gifts to build up the body of Christ, one another, not themselves. And then he's talking in chapter 4 about the new man in Christ. And then where I read this last week, about the things that we do that allow Satan to get a place, a toehold, which leads to a foothold and then a stronghold in our lives. If he has a stronghold in your life, you have allowed a grave enemy into your life and possibly even into your home. Maybe you didn't intend to do so, but you find yourself in a very bad place. In chapter 5, he's talking about walking in love. He's also talking about walking in light. He's talking about walking in wisdom, letting God have his way in your life. Then, if he hadn't said enough, he speaks to us as through the Spirit of God, and he talks to us about marriage and how our marriages are to be the picture of Christ giving himself for the church. Then he's going to talk more about the church. Then in chapter 6, he begins to talk about children obeying their parents in the Lord, for this is right. And he goes all the way back, and he references Deuteronomy chapter 5, where the writer there said, in the very notes that every common Jew and every person who has studied Torah would know, man, when you honor the Lord through honoring your parents, long life shall be added unto you. And this was the promise of God to his children and to us living in the present age. And not only that, he talks about bondservants to their masters. That putting in practicality is how employees represent themselves to their employers. And how we are, even to a corporation that takes and uses our 401k or retirement plan in vain and snuffs it out because they misuse it and abuse. And how we're to be still employees under the Lord Jesus Christ and doing everything that we do as unto the Lord, not unto man. And then, if it weren't enough, now he's going to talk about the armor of God. Why? Because Paul realized in the church at Ephesus, they were under spiritual attack. Now, I want you to know this. In Ephesians chapter 2, Paul said that every good gift and perfect gift that God has reserved for his son, Jesus Christ, and that we can inherit it, it's in heavenly places. Real quick, turn back with me in your Bibles to Hebrews chapter 1. Hebrews chapter 1, or just write this down in the margins of your Bible as I read this to you. In Hebrews chapter 1, there's a verse that says about the angels. Verse 13 says, "But to which of the angels has he ever said, 'Sit at my right hand till I make your enemies your footstool'? Are they not all ministering spirits sent forth to ministers to those who will inherit salvation?" Did you even know that you have been given at least one angel? One angel has been given charge of you. And David alluded to this in the Old Testament. And where are these angels? They are ministering to you here on earth, and they're wrestling against powers and principalities in heavenly places. And though you can't see what's going on, wrestling against you, the forces of evil coming up against you. And I'm not, as one of my seminary professors, a liberal seminary professor who didn't believe in a literal saint. He believed in a force of darkness. I raised my hand and I shouldn't have, but I just had to ask him, oh, you mean like a force like Star Wars? I thought it was kind of silly that a guy should make it all the way to a Southern Baptist seminary and not believe in a literal Satan. But there's always an idiot and a fool somewhere who will discount the Word of God. There's always someone who will take away from the Word of God. And listen, I found in many churches there are always those who will add to the Word of God and make it a rigid, legalistic book that just says, here's what the rules of our life and here's how you're supposed to live according to my indoctrination. Well, whether you take away or add to the Word of life, the Bible tells us in the last book that's written in it, there's a place reserved for those who add to or take away from the Word of God. I'm trying not to editorialize God's Word when I read this to you today, but when he gets to Ephesians chapter 6, and he's not writing down, this is a letter he was writing. We have put chapter and verse separation into it. When he gets to the end of his letter to the church at Ephesus, he wants to tell them the key. And he wants to remind them, and he wants to end on a good note. So this is what he says. If you would stand with me as I read these words to you out of Ephesians chapter 6. Finally, my brethren, he is calling those that he knows as the church at Ephesus. And by the way, Paul's been under house arrest. He's been imprisoned. And he's writing them a letter. In that shape, he's writing them these words. Be strong in the Lord and in the power of his might. Put on the whole armor of God that you may be able to stand against the wiles, the schemes, the games of the devil. For we believers do not wrestle against flesh and blood. We're not wrestling against our mother-in-law, our father-in-law, our in-laws, our family, our bosses. We're not wrestling against our masters. We're not wrestling against one another. We're not wrestling against our best friend who's stolen our girlfriend. We're not wrestling against the other person who's stolen our spouse. We're not wrestling against that person. We're not, Auburn and Alabama are not wrestling. No. That is a temporary match. The permanent match that's been going on ever since Satan's been kicked out of heaven. And God knew even before that, was this war good against evil? For we do not wrestle against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of the darkness of this age. Do you know what that means? As God has a host of angels, as God does, so too, one third of all the angelic realm fell with Lucifer, Satan, and he has given them rank and file. His highest ranking demons or fallen angels, his highest ranking, they have powers and principles. Picture a boardroom in the heavenlies, and he's meeting with them because he can't be everywhere. He gives them duties and assignments to come back and report to him, and you may be on their report. We fight against these principalities, against powers, against the rulers of the darkness of this age, against spiritual host of wickedness in the heavenly places. Therefore, take up the whole armor of God that you may be able to withstand in, and underline this, the evil day, and having done all, to stand. Stand therefore, having girded your waist with truth. The Word of God is truth. Jesus is the Word of God. He is the belt, and you must wear it to keep everything else in and to keep everything else on. Having put on the breastplate of righteousness, and we know that he is our righteousness, and having shod your feet with the preparation of the gospel of peace, not just, if you would, sandals, but sandals with cleats, so that you can, against the enemy, take back the territory that Satan has stolen in your life. Above all, taking the shield of faith with which you will be able to quench all the fiery darts of the wicked one. and take the helmet of salvation and the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God, praying always with all prayer and supplication in the Spirit, being watchful to this end with all perseverance and supplication for all the saints. Now watch this, and for me, that utterance may be given to me, that I may open my mouth boldly to make known the mystery of the gospel. Wow. Wow. God, may we put this into action today. In Christ's name I pray. Amen. You may be seated. I'm not proud of this, but I was sure proud of my mom and daddy years ago when they went down to Venice, Florida to start a new church. And man, I wish I could tell you the whole story, but for sake of time, they depleted their entire retirement account for that church, Colonial Baptist. For 8 years, nothing happened. I mean, 50, 60 people would meet in the Venice Community Civic Center. And they had a fund to start a building fund, and my dad was given 5 acres of land for a church as long as they built within 5 years. And it was days away from that having to begin when a gentleman in the church stepped out and said, "How much do we need?" And then it all started. God just miracle after miracle after miracle. So they built a building, and my daddy asked me to come down to preach the grand dedication for Colonial Baptist Church. So I'm down there, and I'm preaching the message, and I'm preaching about the church overpowering the enemies and how that church, Colonial, had done everything they could all through those years. And we were now celebrating the fact that we were entering a building debt-free. Debt-free, millions of dollars given, debt-free, miracle after miracle. It was such a proud, honoring moment for that church, for my parents, and for all the folks who had worked so hard to see that to come to a real entity. And the building now stood, and so I'm preaching, and I mean, the place was packed for a little small church. The place was packed, and they were excited, and getting down to the invitation time, and I talked about the fiery darts of Satan and how Satan throws those fiery darts. And I wanted, and I meant to say the fiery darts of Satan, but it was a mistake. It rhymed with darts, but it wasn't exactly darts. And as I was preaching, I was like, wow, there's some folks really turning red here. And then I saw my father just like, no, he was looking through the scripture, and this is not King James, I know. Then my mother was almost under the pew. I mean, my sister, who not regularly goes to church, she was laughing. And I looked at poor Mary over on the organ, and Mary was behind the organ hiding. And oh my goodness. I just knew, and I just kept on going, and no one could recover. They were all giggling, and I'm like, it was a dart, but he went to a Mexican restaurant the night before. I tried to recapture them, but I had lost them. It was my biggest mistake in church life. The fiery darts of Satan. Do you know what Paul's talking about there? Picture, if you would, back in the Wild West, when the cowboys would go out, when the settlers first went out west, and they tried to invade Indian territory. This was the Indians' homeland. And they would kill the white man coming in. I guess so, because we wanted their land. So they started killing us. So we discovered the importance of a covered wagon, because the cowboys would go, the settlers would go and hide behind the wagon or in the wagon, and the Indians couldn't see them. Then the settlers started getting guns and killing the Indians. It was unfair. So the Indians started putting their arrows in tar, and then they would shoot them, and they would burn up the covered wagon. Excuse me, it's hot up here, y'all. The Indians loved it when the wagons were uncovered. Then they would shoot and kill the cowboys, the settlers. And this is what happened in the Roman time too. The Roman army had this 2.5 foot by 4 foot long shield that they had. And they'd take this shield, and it was usually typically to arm all their thousands of men, their soldiers, they would give them wooden shields. If you were a high-ranking soldier, you'd get a shield with maybe an armor covered, or a shield that was covered, but most of their shields were wood. So before they went into battle, they would cover them either with animal skin, or they would soak them in water all night long, so that when they took them into battle, the enemies had discovered that as long as they had fire-tipped arrows, they could shoot and kill. But when those shields were soaked in water and the animal skins were covered in water, the flame went out. Satan's fiery darts are coming at you. You know why? Because he can't be in all those places. And you and I, as parents, are to shoot our children like arrows at the enemy. Where we can't go, we shoot our children. We should be propelling our children and the next generation to go further than we ever went, spiritually speaking. But here's the problem. We're retreating because like the people of Ephesus and the church at Ephesus, we're overwhelmed and succumbing to our culture. It's killing us in the church today. It's crushing and giving blow after blow. The enemy is just taking territory in our lives. He's taking territory in our homes. He's taking territory in our churches. We keep giving them. We don't realize what we have been given. The physical world is not where you and I see Satan. A lot of people like to see Satan in a little red suit with a pitchfork, and it's a cartoon caricature. And it makes him look like a cartoon figure. But he is not a cartoon figure. He likes that old European Dark Ages outfit that we give him. He loves that. Because when we laugh and scoff at him and make it like no big deal, he loves it because he deals best in the area of deception. The physical world produces a fruit that is seen and is given evidence of. The psychological world produces this shoot. But watch this now. The spiritual world produces a seed or the root which produces the shoot, which produces. You've got to nip this, as Barney said, you've got to nip this in the bud. You've got to go back to the seed, to the very root of the problem. And there remains the problem. We do not live and walk by sight. We walk by faith. But most of us are not walking by faith. We don't see the spiritual world. We like living and dwelling in the physical world where we can see, and everything is manifest by what we touch and what we feel, by what we can sense. And we can't sense Satan, and we certainly can't sense in any way the angel that God has given charge over us. We can't see his heavenly host going to battle for us. We don't know that we have some tools and armor that we can wear that Scripture tells us that we should put on and have on, and that can protect us and, in fact, take back the territory and the ground that Satan has stolen. The first three pieces of God's uniform we are always to wear as believers. Always. Once Jesus Christ comes into your heart, you're given a robe, his robe of righteousness. He is our righteousness. So we put on that robe. It's like a uniform. And I've taken the time to show you Detroit Tigers uniform, even though Cabrera is no longer a Tiger. But, you know, a Detroit Tiger uniform includes the following: the shirt, a belt, the pants. I mean, everyone's got to wear those. You've got cleats. That's a part of the uniform that you put on. You don't go out of the dugout. You don't go out of the training center, really, for a game without a Detroit Tiger uniform on when you play for the Detroit Tigers. Even when you're at practice, they have a practice uniform. However, every player, every ball player knows that there are certain things that you don't take all the time out into the field. Like, you don't take a glove when you sit down in the dugout. You don't just sit there with your glove on, punching your glove, because it's time to go to bat. So you put the glove off. When you go out to the field is when you pick up you take up the glove. When you go up to bat is when you take the bat. You don't stand in the dugout all the time swinging the bat. You take it up. And there's certain things as a believer that you put on and you keep on at all times. Are you a closet Christian? Have you taken off the uniform? Have you just said to yourself, I want my church friends, my church family to know I'm a part of Hillcrest family, but when I go to work, I've got to separate the two. There's this wall that has to be there. I mean, people just take advantage of me if they know I'm a Christian. Y'all know that. So I can't be soft. So you've sold yourself or allowed yourself to be sold a bag of goods by the deceiver, the devil, who's the accuser of the brethren. You've been deceived to believe that you have two separate uniforms. No, when you became his, you've put on the new man, the uniform of Christ, the armor of Christ. So Paul is simply saying to you, put on the whole armor of God. That means you never go out without your uniform on. You don't do these things. The shirt, the pants, the shoes, the belt, these are always worn, but the helmet, the baseball bat, the glove are things you take up. And then Paul talks about the evil day. Let me talk about just personally the evil day. When is the evil day? Well, for every one of us, the evil day could be different. The evil day is when all here on earth in the physical world seems to turn to, it just all hell on earth seems to take over. Now, to some of you, that's like a cuss word. To some of you, though, you've gone through hell on earth. Some of you may even say, I've gone through a Job-like experience. I think if you study the book of Job, none of us really have. That was a test of many different levels. No one that I know of in this church has lost 10 children in one setting. 10 children. His wife was so depleted, defeated, discouraged, that she finally said, Job, curse God and die, be done with it. It wasn't because she wasn't a good wife. She saw him and her go through the loss of, have you ever had a day that you just didn't even want to pull open the blinds? Not because you were just sick, not because you just had one thing after another, because you thought, if you pulled open the blinds and said, welcome to the world, another day of hell on earth was coming. Have you ever gone through a period of time like that? Have you ever gone through a period of time where you said to yourself, I got to get out of this bed. I got to put one foot in front of the other. If I don't, no one else is going to do it for me. The kids, they just got to see me going through it, because I just got to be an example. And then you get to that point in your life, you say, I can't go anymore, God. I don't know why you've done this to me. And you think that God's done this to you. God is not doing that to you. Life happens. I'm going to prove that to you in just a moment through this text. Life happens to good and bad people. It rains on the just and the unjust alike. Paul is saying, put on the uniform of the Lord Jesus Christ and take up. And the first thing that he tells people to take up, man, he's like, you got to take up the shield of faith. The shield of faith. Have you ever thought about the shield of faith? I want to describe what the shield of faith is. The Roman shield that Paul could have been alluding to so that people had a word picture in mind was a 2.5 foot wide by a 4 foot long shield. And I told you about that shield. It gave people the picture, but if you would, in our mind, we can see certain things and we're like, man, that's powerful. But when you see, or when you used to see, the space shuttle coming back to Earth, remember, on the bottom, really, the whole spacecraft, it's surrounded by what's called the TPS. It's a thermal protection system. And it's made up of tiles and blankets underneath those tiles that are fabricated of certain products that you and I can't get our hands on. But it's meant to take temperatures up to 3,000 degrees Fahrenheit when it comes back into the Earth's atmosphere. And the bottom tiles of the space shuttle, when it comes in, it's like on fire. And those astronauts, they totally have confidence in the shield that is protecting them in that aircraft. They know that it's been tested and tried, and that it can withstand the attack of the heat that space shuttle is under and remember the time that it didn't. I wonder if the astronauts, every time they come back into Earth's atmosphere, if they think about those 14 or so that lost their lives just going up and through. I wonder if they think that and they trust that. But the shield of faith for the Christian should be so much more so. Now, if you ever saw the movie with Mel Gibson, Braveheart, remember when he's gone up and down the battle line on his horse, and he's giving courage into the hearts, the brave hearts of those who are protecting their homeland. And some are turning and running, and he's trying to convince them. And so he's got those men ready, and he gives them shields, and he's telling them to wait until the enemy is right upon them with those long pitchforks, or those hooks that are ready to go in them. And he's telling them, hold, hold, hold. Remember that in the movie? I knew you would. And then he finally says, now, and they put them up, and those steel goes into those shields. And then those men with Gibson take over. I thought it was a great time in a movie. It made me think of this, the shield of faith. But even that is weak and wrong. When I began studying the shield of faith for this sermon, I was like, wow, am I a weak Christian? Wow. My wife, who has the gift of faith, and I know many of you have had the gift of faith, your spiritual gift is faith, you have an important tool that the church needs. You're the ones who have like the shield. Now, all of us have a shield, but you have a force. You have like a hotline to heaven. You can teach us how to be better in our faith, but you have been given a gift that you should be utilizing in a great way. All of us have this shield of faith, and it's really important that you know what the shield of faith is. It is a spiritual shield that protects us from the enemy's fiery darts. And he knows how to put it to you. He is, watch this now. I know that most of us are football fans. He has studied the game tapes. He can't be in your life every day. He can't know all things about you. God knows everything about you. He knows the number of days that you will live. He knows the hairs of your head or the lack thereof. Listen to me. He knows the tears that you'll shed. He stored them all up in a bottle. Now, that's just not the literal there. That's not a figurative sense. I believe God cares about the tiniest little details of your life. And one day, we will understand it all. He knows what he's doing, and he's given us a shield of faith to protect us from the enemy. He knows the trouble that you're in. Oh, I don't know about that, preacher. I think he's just left me alone. You feel that way. Listen to me. You feel that way. Because stuff happens in life, and it just comes heavy on us. And we don't think we can take any more. But according to 1 Corinthians 10:13, Paul wrote, he knows the level of temptation or test that you're under, and he's not only provided a way of escape, but he has prepared for you the way for you to journey in it. He wants you to stick in it. He wants you to move through the fire. He doesn't want to bring you out of it. He wants to walk with you in the midst of it. He has not left you. He has not left you. It's not what you feel that's important. Feelings come and go. It's what you know. Look and believe in your heart. Did you know there's not a grace chapter in our Bible? Nope. We like to focus today on the age of grace, but then we learn what's crazy in Hebrews chapter 12, Hebrews chapter 11, we've got the great faith chapter in the Bible. And the large majority of the names that are in that faith chapter are Old Testament saints. They had faith. Go with me back to Hebrews chapter 11, would you please? Hebrews chapter 11, where it mentions all these great heroes in the faith. Abel in verse 4, and Enoch in verse 5 and Noah in verse 7 and Abraham in verse 8 and Sarah in verse 11. All of these, and then Abraham again in verse 17, who by faith, and all of these names are referenced, and then it says by faith, and they reference the name. The author there goes into detail about Jacob and Joseph and Moses, and then he talks about Rahab the harlot, Gideon, Barak, Samson, Jephthah, David, Samuel, prophets who through faith subdued kingdoms, worked righteousness, obtained promises, stopped the mouths of lions, quenched the violence of fire. How? Shield of faith. And they didn't even have the Holy Spirit of God. You and I have the Holy indwelling power of God. They did not have what you and they did not have the completed word of God. You and I have been told about them so that we can take stock and that we can know and believe in our heart and have faith that God will overcome. Do you know that you're more than a conqueror? Do you know it, or do you just feel that way today? Oh, this is good, Pastor. Just keep pumping me. I needed this. I needed to feel better. No, you don't. Don't trust those feelings. Trust what you know in your heart and in your head, that the Word of God, the belt by which you are girded with, His truth, the Word of God and the sword of the Spirit, you can depend on God. You can get through this. I can do all things who strengthens me, Paul said. And we can do that too. The shield of faith is a defensive tool, but it is also an offensive tool when used correctly, because faith is a victory. Now, this is what's called a hymn book. You can laugh if you wish, but this had songs in it with actual lyrics and notes that people were to read. Most people couldn't, but they would, in times past in church life, instead of reading things on the screen, people would say, the song leader would say, turn with me to hymn number such and such. And on 720 in the celebration hymnal, you have this song called Faith is the Victory by John Yates. He had gone through a tremendous trial in his life and had studied the armor of God. He wrote in verse 1, encamped along the hills of light, ye Christian soldiers rise, and press the battle ere the night shall veil the glowing skies. Against the foe, in veils below, let all our strength be hurled. Faith is the victory we know that overcomes the world. Verse 3 is, on every hand the foe we find, drawn up in dread array. Let tents of ease be left behind and onward to the fray. Like, let's get to this battle. Salvation's helmet on each head with truth girt about. The earth shall tremble neath our tread and echo with our shout. I know this is old King James language, but that was the language of the common man in the day. And people would get to songs like this. Now listen to me. People would get to songs like this, lyrics written so rich with biblical doctrinal content, but they couldn't sing these songs. They were just so boring in church. So the preachers would go with the composers, the lyrical people, into the pubs and the taverns and hear the song of the common man. And they would take the music of the commoner and they would put the lyrics of these great theological content-driven songs to the songs that people, to the music people were listening to, and guess what? People started singing them in church and having fun doing it. They liked the songs. They liked the hymns. All contemporary music becomes traditional in time. There's nothing wrong with taking music and making it new. That's what these hymn books were all about. And then he'd get to the fourth, and he said, to him that overcomes the foe, white raiment shall be given. Before the angels he shall know his name confessed in heaven. Then onward from the hills of light, our hearts with love aflame will vanquish all the host of night in Jesus' conquering name. My friend, This is all about, this whole entire song is all about the shield of faith. And here it is, there's a chapter in our Bible about how many Old Testament saints took the shield of faith up. They had faith to believe in God. They didn't have the Word of God. They didn't have the Spirit of God. They didn't even know about the Holy Spirit. Didn't even know. And we know all about Him because He's come into us and He dwells within us. We have sensed His Spirit, and yet we think that sense is a feeling, and we lose the feeling, and so we're like, oh, I'm going to get defeated. No, my friend, you're not going to get defeated. God's not going to allow you to be defeated. He's going to use you because you are His child. He wants you to go through it. He wants to bring you through it. He wants you to bring the shield of faith, to take up the shield of faith and to put it on, His armor. 1 John 5, verse 4, this is the victory that has overcome the world, even our faith. Hebrews 11, 33 and 34, look with me there, or listen to me as I read you these. Who through faith subdued kingdoms, worked righteousness, obtained promises, stopped the mouth of lions, quenched the violence of fire, escaped the edge of the sword, out of weakness were made strong, became valiant in battle, turned to flight the armies of the aliens. It's just unbelievable. It goes on in 1 Samuel chapter 17. David is going and visiting his brother with a care package. Saul and the armies of Israel are out encamped against the enemy. And every day, Satan has a great deceiver in a giant-sized man called Goliath who goes out there and shouts profanities at all of the army of Israel and against the God of Israel. And David can't believe it. He's just 17 years old. He can't believe it. And Saul takes him in his tent, and David says, give me, I'll go. I don't care. God's given us victory. I stand on His promise. You know what David had? Shield of faith. Shield of faith. So David said, I'll go. Saul says, here, take my armor. Saul's this huge guy. David's a 17-year-old kid. He's like, here, put on my armor. So David puts it on, and he feels so clunked down. I don't need this. He takes it back off. He takes the shield of faith. He takes a little slingshot, five smooth stones. He goes out, not because he's cocky, arrogant, confident that he'll do something on his own. No. He already knew Jesus Christ had promised victory. Of course Israel's going to win. Of course I'm going to take this guy's head off. Of course we're going to be victorious today. He had faith. You say, I don't know if I can have that kind of faith. I know you don't know it because you may not feel that way today, but you have that kind of faith. It is a force shield of faith that you have been given. Listen to this. Psalm 3:3, David said, but you, O Lord, are a shield for me. In Psalms 18, verse 2, he said, the Lord is my rock and my fortress, strong place, and my deliverer, my God, my strength, in whom I will trust, my shield, and the horn of my salvation, my stronghold. In chapter 28, verse 7, he said, the Lord is my strength and my shield. My heart trusts in Him, and I am helped. Therefore, my heart greatly rejoices, and with my song I will praise Him. Did you know that at one time Israel had a bunch of singers, a choir, that went out before their army, and they sang songs to their enemies before they stomped them into the ground? When our choir takes the choir loft, I expect them to come out with a song. I assume they're ready and they're going to lead us into a heart of worship. Of course they are. They go before us and the songs of the Lord, because they're like a shield. They're putting up, not just taking up the armor of God, they're putting it on for us, getting our hearts ready. God inhabits the praise of His people. Why? Because we're getting ready to act in faith against the armies of the world, against the armies of the enemy, because we know His arrows are pointed exactly at us. We know His arrows are pointed at the church. We know His arrows are pointed at our hearts. We know that Satan wants to deceive us to make us feel certain ways. God wants us to know and to believe and to act in faith. Psalm 119, verse 14. 114, you're my hiding place and my shield. I hope in your word. Psalm 144, 1 and 2, blessed be the Lord, my rock, who trains my hands for war, my fingers for battle, my loving kindness, my fortress, my high tower, my deliverer, my shield, and the one in whom I do take refuge, who subdues my people under me. Did you know in Habakkuk chapter 2, verse 4, that Habakkuk wrote, the just shall live by faith. Do you have the shield of faith? Have you taken up the shield of faith? Paul said in 2 Corinthians 5, verse 7, we walk by faith and not by sight. David was shielded by faith. He didn't have the dwelling Holy Spirit of God. He didn't have this book of history telling him of other greats of the past who had been delivered. Now, there might have at that time been some writings of Scripture, but David coming up in a poor man's family, he wouldn't have had that. But he had heard through his daddy, Jesse, that there was a God of Israel that cared and had his hand pronounced on the people and the children of Israel. And David knew that if he pleased God and took up the shield of faith, that he would be fine. He believed in what he heard that his father had translated him about this God. Do you believe just on what your pastor gives you, orally translate to you? Or do you take the word of God, the sword of the Spirit, and do you apply that to your life? Is it possible, just possible, plausible, that you are not putting on the armor of God daily, and so you feel hopeless and helpless against the enemy, and like his arrows are just taking you down every day, that you cannot do anything? It's just like, I just feel like quitting and giving up. Well, yeah. If you don't take the offensive tools, the sword of the Spirit, if you don't take the shield of faith and present it to the enemy, you're just getting knocked back, knocked down, and he's taking you out. Why? So that he can take a report to God the Father and say, have you considered my servant there? They're about depleted. They're about defeated. You are an overcomer. Faith will help you to overcome. Ladies, I want you to look at the screen. This is a man named Brian Shaw, especially you widows, if you would. And in 2013, this is the strongest man in the world champion. I kind of like his shorts. But he's lifting there 1,122 pounds. It was a world record at the time. Now, ladies, I want to ask you a question. If Brian Shaw can deadlift 1,122 pounds, do you think he could carry your grocery bag from the grocery store to the car? And I know what some of you ladies are saying, he could carry my grocery bags to my car. Sure could. I'd send him right, I'd take him home and he can carry him right on into the house. Yeah. I remember back to the 1996 Olympics. I love the Olympics. I remember the women's gymnastic team and Kelly Strung. It was down to the last event. In fact, it was the last portion of the last event. She was on the vault and she made her first attempt. She ran down that aisle hard, hit the vault, sprung up in the air, turned over, two ligaments messed up, foot highly damaged. She told Bella, her coach, I can't do it again. I'm done. Well, we're not going to win, Carrie. It'll disqualify you, and we won't be the Russians. The Russians were just going crazy. Then Bella Caroli, her coach, started saying, you can do it, Carrie. You can do it, Carrie. Remember that? Remember that? And as she ran down again, she hit that ball. You can do it, Carrie. She hit that ball, she landed on 2 feet, lifted up her left. They won that year by just a few points because this is what she said. They asked her how she was able to do this. Listen to what Carrie said. When Bella says you can do it, you just have the belief that you can because he's such a good coach. You can do this. You can make it. And you can take back the turf and the enemy's territory that he's taken in your life, in your home, in your church, in your community. Listen, our country looks like it's on the way down, doesn't it? Every week someone hits, and it's just crazy what's going on. it starts one person, one church, one community at a time, one revival, and it starts with me. It starts with me. You can do this. He said it. He's given us his word, the sword of the Spirit and the shield of faith. Do you believe? Right now, I'm going to give you a chance. If you don't know Christ, you need to step up and say, Christ, come into my heart. I know I'm a sinner. I believe that you died on the cross. I believe that I am in need of your forgiveness. I give you my heart. I give you my life. I give you everything. I'm ready to follow you. If that's you, you need to come to this altar. If you're a Christian, you've not been using the force of faith, the shield of faith, the sword of the Spirit, the word of God, and the power of his Spirit intestinally and internally, you need to today come back and start claiming lost territory, lost turf to the enemy. Oh God, I pray that you would give us those who would come to this altar.